Good morning. Happy Father's Day to all the fathers. Thank you. Oh, let's see. This afternoon. Pastor Jake, can you be back this afternoon?
Yes.
Okay. Choir practice, 4:45. There is a pianist meeting at 5:15. Men's prayer will also be at 5:15. And our evening worship tonight will be at 6 p.m. This Wednesday at 7 p.m., our prayer service and summer Bible time. And next Sunday in the evening service, the DeShanko family will be with us to present their ministry. The next Ruth meeting is July 1st. And also on July 1st, after the Ruth meeting, is a VBS decoration workshop. On the 2nd, we'll be observing the Lord's Supper. There will also be a teen fellowship on the afternoon on the 2nd. And then it's July 4th. July coming up quick. VBS prayer and setup on July 8th. And then VBS is the 10th through the 14th. Our missionary of the month this month is the Patterson family. This week and next week are the last weeks to give towards them. So if you'd like to give towards the gift for them, please see myself or Vernon. And I believe that's all I have.
Thank you very much, Liberty. Again, good morning. Welcome to our service. Happy Father's Day to all of our fathers. Praise God for you, especially if you are a dad that loves the Lord, that is teaching your children how to live for Christ. That is a great blessing, and we're thankful for you. I'm going to ask you, if you will, please, to open your hymnals, and we'll begin with hymn number 434. 434, let's stand together as we sing, Jesus, what a friend, our great Savior.
Thank you.
Amen. Good singing. Let's pray together. Lord God in heaven, we praise you for our great Savior. We thank you for the love that you showed us in sending Jesus to die for our sins. We thank you, Father, for sending him from the glories of heaven to come to this world to be our God in the flesh. We thank you, Lord, for his words, for his works. We thank you especially for the shedding of his blood on our behalf. We know, Lord, without that, there is no remission of sin. We thank you that he shed his blood, that he died, was buried. We praise you for the power of his resurrection. He rose again over the power of sin, the power of darkness. We praise you, dear Father, for his ascension into glory where our Savior lives. We praise you that he ever lives to make intercession for us. And Lord, we thank you for this church that you have blessed us with. Thankful for those that are a part of this ministry, those that you have brought together this morning. Our prayer, Father, is that you would work a work in our midst for your glory. We do think of Pastor Jake this morning as he'll be preaching down at Pastor Johnny Bickle's church this morning. We pray that you would empower him. Pray, Lord, that you would give him your mind and give him clarity as he brings forth the word of God. And I do pray as your word goes forth here this morning, that our hearts would be encouraged in you. That, Lord, we would know that you are in total control of our lives. We thank you for all that you have done and look forward to what you are going to do. Lord, our prayer is that you would work through us, that we would see your will accomplished. Pray that you would work in us, Lord, that as we go forth with the message of the gospel, that we would see folks say, Lord, we know that that is near and dear to your heart. You sent your son to die for men's sins. And I pray, Father, that we would have that same burden as we go into this world, that we would share what you have entrusted us with. You have commanded us to go into all the world to preach the gospel. And we pray, Lord, that we would see the results of that as men and women come to know you as Savior. I pray that you would use our ministry also to build up your people. Lord, we are constantly bombarded by this world. And I ask you, Lord, to work in us that we would look unto Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith. That, Father, we would consider him who endured such contradiction of sinners against himself, lest we be wearied and faint in our minds. Help us not to faint. I do pray that as we worship you this morning, that our thoughts, our hearts would be in tune with yours. I pray, Lord, that we would not be distracted by the cares we may have come in with, by some activity that we may be anticipating. But, Lord, that we would praise you and honor you. Lord, that our attention would be toward you, that we would give heed to your word and desire to apply it in our everyday lives. Lord God, you are worthy of our praise. You are worthy of all glory and honor. And I pray that you would be magnified in our midst here this morning. Lord, we do ask you to work a work in our missionaries. We are thankful for them. We praise you, Lord, for our missionary of the month, the Patterson family. Thankful, Lord, for Brother Allen and Sister Jan and the work that you are accomplishing through them. We do pray that you would guide them, direct them. Pray, Father, that you would give safety as they travel to these different mission fields, desiring to establish new works for you. And Lord, I pray that that the gospel would go forth, that you would empower our brother as he preaches the word. We do pray, Father, for Jan and ask you just to comfort her physically. You see the issues, Lord, with arthritis. We pray that you would just help her, Father, to maintain day by day, accomplishing the things you have called her to do also. And together, may they accomplish the work you have given to them. Lord, we pray for all of our missionaries and ask you to encourage them. We do think of the Dyshenkos as they'll be coming out at the end of the month. We pray, Father, that you would protect them as they travel. Prepare them, Father, for the ministry they'll be presenting here. And I pray, Lord, that we would be encouraged by what you're doing through them. Again, Lord, we thank you for the opportunities we have had to be able to reach out to the military locally. I do pray that you would open doors once again, Lord, for us to be able to have access down to the base, to be able to reach those who are lost, to be able to encourage those who are saved. We pray, Lord, that you would open those doors as you see fit. And we pray for our men and women in uniform, Lord, who are on our battlefields today. We pray that you would protect them. We pray that you would watch over them. Those who are not saved, we pray that you would minister to them through the gospel message, that you would put people in their paths, that would teach them and encourage them from the word of God, that they would be saved. Lord, we just pray that you would work in our midst here today. You know the needs of the people that are here. And Lord, I pray that our worship would magnify you, would magnify your word, and draw your people closer to you. As we leave here, Lord, may we know, thus saith the Lord. And we'll give you the glory for all that will be done. We ask it in Jesus' marvelous name. Amen. You may be seated. If you will, turn in your hymnals then to hymn number 423. Before we sing this, I do want to read a thank you note. This is a thank you note from Pastor and Laura Neal. He says, "Dear Pastor Jones and CBC family, what a blessing it was to see each of you again. Thank you so much for your extremely generous love offering you gave to us. Wow. Each of you were so encouraging to us. We wanted our children to meet you, to experience the love of Jesus Christ. We will never forget the kindness and love that you constantly display for God and his glory. We love you, David and Laura." Let's remember to keep them in prayer as they serve up there in Wisconsin. All right, hymn number 423, Redeemed. Amen. This time we'll have our scripture reading.
If you'll turn with me in your Bibles to the book of John, John chapter 15. John 15, we'll read the first seven verses. If you'll stand with me for the reading of God's word. "I am the true vine, and my Father is the husbandman. Every branch in me that beareth not fruit, he taketh away. And every branch that beareth fruit, he purgeth it, that it may bring forth more fruit. Now ye are clean through the word which I have spoken unto you. Abide in me, and I in you. As the branch cannot bear fruit of itself, except it abide in the vine, no more can ye, except ye abide in me. I am the vine, ye are the branches. He that abideth in me, and I in him, the same bringeth forth much fruit. For without me ye can do nothing. If a man abide not in me, he is cast forth as a branch, and is withered. And men gather them, and cast them into the fire, and they are burned. If ye abide in me, and my words abide in you, ye shall ask what ye will, and it shall be done unto you." You may be seated.
Amen. You will take your hymnals again and turn to hymn number 243. This time we will have special music.
Teach me thy way, O
Amen. Thank you very much, Liberty. I'm going to ask you to open your Bibles to John chapter 15. When my family and I were on vacation, Brother Dave spoke while I was away, and he preached from John chapter 15, and it was such a wonderful sermon, and the Lord just kept impressing me to come back to John chapter 15. And so I thought, well, Lord, it's Father's Day. Can't I come up with some kind of a Father's Day thing? And all he said was, well, maybe next year. But anyway, we're going to go through a different aspect of John chapter 15. If you look at the last verse of John chapter 14, the Lord says to his disciples, "Arise, let us go hence." He had spent some time with these men. He was trying to calm their fears, their troubled hearts. He had given them several promises that once they believed them and once they understood them, that through them they would be greatly encouraged. But it wasn't the Lord's purpose in these encouragements, folks, to merely encourage them, merely to comfort them. The Lord was also preparing them for the calling that he had given to them. Just like us. Do you know that the Word of God is not merely just for you to be comforted? Right. It's for you to be commissioned to do the work that God has called you to do. And so while they were waiting there, Jesus wanted them to be committed to the work he had called them to do. And if you were really to look at the discourse here, you would see that there were two things that the Lord Jesus Christ mentioned to them. There were two purposes, and one of them, and chapter 14 is really filled with this, is that they would be comforted, right? Let not your heart be troubled. He did want to comfort them, but there is, as I said, the second purpose, and that is to commission them. It's not enough just to know the teachings of the Lord. They were going to have to do something with them. And it's the same with us. It's not enough for us just to have a great understanding and knowledge of God. God expects us to do something with it. And so it was time for the Lord to challenge them to the next stage of their discipleship. It was time for them to launch out on their own because he was going to be gone. And so the Lord is up. He's moving with them. You may recall his destination is the Garden of Gethsemane. That's where ultimately he is going to be with them. And on the way there, Jesus taught his disciples about some of the demands that they would experience as his disciples and the conditions under which they could be effective for him. And these teachings are actually recorded both in chapters 15 and chapter 16. And then somewhere along the line, you may recall that he stops and he prays, and that's recorded in John chapter 17. So Jesus begins this teaching on the run, if you will. He had just left. He said, let's up and go. And so on the way, he begins teaching them with an allegory, right? That's what he starts with. And of course, an allegory is a teaching in which people, things, or happenings are given symbolic meaning for the use of explaining ideas and moral principles. So it's using one thing that is familiar to explain something that might be on a higher plane, a spiritual truth. And that's what the Lord is doing here. And in the allegory of John chapter 15, not only do we see the allegory, we also see metaphors. And a metaphor is a figure of speech. It really contains an implied comparison. Okay? For instance, the world is a stage, right? We know the world's really not a stage, but that's just a use of the idea that the world is like a stage, right? It implies similarity. Well, in the first 16 verses of John chapter 15, we have the allegory of the vine, which is going to teach the disciples of Christ the importance of overall fruitfulness. Do you know that's God's desire for each of us? In everything that God tries to accomplish in our lives, ultimately, it's for the purpose of us being fruitful. We even see in James tells us that we're to count it all joy when we fall into divers temptations, right? Yeah. We're called to rejoice because God accomplishes something, James says. He accomplishes what? Do you remember? Patience. And he says, let patience have his work, right? His perfect work. But folks, patience isn't even the end. It's another means to what? To fruitfulness, right? God wants us to be fruitful. And that's what Jesus is talking about in these chapters, in these couple of chapters. And that fruitfulness is not the result of our own ability or our own achievement, but it is as we abide in the Lord Jesus Christ as believers. In verses 1 to 3, we see that there are actually three metaphors that the Lord uses to explain this particular teaching. Let's look at verses 1 to 3 of Matthew 15. Jesus says, I am the true vine, and my Father is the husbandman. Every branch in me that beareth not fruit, he taketh away. And every branch that beareth fruit, he purgeth it, that it may bring forth more fruit. Now ye are clean through the word which I have spoken unto you. Now first we have, Jesus identifies himself here as the true vine. And second, he identifies the Father, God the Father, as what? He's the husbandman. What is a husbandman? Right, somebody that takes care of agriculture, right? Could be a farmer, but in this case, it would be a what? What might we call him? Somebody that takes care of vines. What do we call him? Do we talk to? I don't know, vine dresser, right? Something like that. So the husbandman would be the one that takes care of the vine in this story. And so we have a vine, we have a vine dresser, and verse 2 introduces us to the what? Every branch. And who or what do the branches represent? Jesus tells us right in the very beginning of verse 5, right? He says, I am the vine and ye are the branches. Now, I think that the basic allegory here is pretty simple, right? I mean, we get the idea of a vine and the branches that come off of a vine. There is a relationship, right? There's this relationship between the fruit-bearing branches, which represent true Christians, and the life-giving vine that represents Jesus Christ. There is no life in the vine in the branches apart from the vine, the Lord Jesus Christ. But the Lord makes a subtle distinction here that I really like to highlight, and I just like this stuff, okay? But in verse 1, first of all, verse 5, Jesus says, I am the vine, right? But in verse 1, he makes a distinction. He says that he was the what vine? True. Well, true. When the Lord used the word true, you need to think true in comparison to what? Right? Or not, right? I mean, true, that should come to our mind. He calls himself the true vine, but true in comparison to what? Why did the Lord pick this specific metaphor to teach his disciples? Because to those in Jerusalem, this vine had a greater significance than any one of us would imagine, right? We just think of the allegory. We know about vines. We think the Lord is just using this as a story to illustrate a truth. We know about vines. We know about how branches are connected to vines. We know about fruit bearing. But I'm going to ask you to keep your finger here and jump back to Psalm 80. And bear with me. I'm going to be going through quite a few verses here. I just want us to get an idea of what Jesus is saying here. Because to me, this is rich. After I came across this, when I read this passage, I don't read it the same way as I used to. But if you look at Psalm 80, follow with me as I read, beginning in verse 7. He says, turn us again, O God of hosts, and cause thy face to shine, and we shall be saved. Thou hast brought a vine out of Egypt. Thou hast cast out the heathen and planted it. Thou preparest room before it, and did cause it to take deep root, and it filled the land. The hills were covered with the shadow of it, and the boughs thereof were like the goodly cedars. She sent out her boughs unto the sea, and her branches unto the river. Now, who is the vine that the Lord planted here? Israel. He's the one that he took them out of Egypt, right? So verse 8 refers to God delivering them out of Egypt and casting out the heathen in the conquest of Canaan. And then how God had planted this vine in his promised land. So Israel was this vine that he had planted in the promised land. Now, folks, when somebody plants a vineyard, what is the expectation? Right? Fruit, right? I mean, I have grapevines in my backyard, and for the first 3 years, I expected fruit and got none. And last year, I got a whole bunch of grapes, right? That was my expectation. I was happy when that happened, right? The years before, I wasn't happy because I was expecting to get grapes and there was no fruit whatsoever. And so the expectation here, God planted this vineyard. It was Israel. His expectation was that they would bear fruit. Now I'm going to ask you to jump over to Isaiah chapter 5. Isaiah chapter 5. Hopefully I don't lose you here. Isaiah chapter 5, beginning in verse 1. Isaiah says, "Now will I sing to my well-beloved a song of my beloved touching his vineyard. My well-beloved had a vineyard in a very fruitful hill, and he fenced it and gathered out the stones thereof and planted it with the choicest vine and built a tower in the midst of it and also made a wine press therein. And he looked that it should bring forth grapes, and it brought forth wild grapes. And now, O inhabitants of Jerusalem and men of Judah, judge, I pray you, betwixt me and my vineyard. What could have been done more to my vineyard than that I have not done in it? Wherefore, when I looked that it should bring forth grapes, brought forth wild grapes. And now go to, I will tell you what I will do to my vineyard. I will take away the hedge thereof, and it shall be eaten up, and break down the wall thereof, and it shall be trodden down. And I will lay it waste. It shall not be pruned nor digged, but there shall come up briars and thorns. I will also command the clouds that they rain no rain upon it. For the vineyard of the Lord of hosts is the house of Israel, and the men of Judah his pleasant plant. And he looked for judgment, but behold, oppression, for righteousness, but behold, a cry." So here God planted Israel, expecting good fruit, but instead, very obviously, what kind of fruit did he get? Wild fruit. He was expecting righteousness and true judgment, but he found unrighteousness and oppression. So here was a vine that was not bearing the expected fruit. Jump over to Jeremiah chapter 2. Jeremiah chapter 2. Verse 21, God says through Jeremiah, he says, "Yet I had planted thee a noble vine, wholly a right seed. How then art thou turned into the degenerate plant of a strange vine unto me?" So what was the Lord's response to their unfruitfulness? Jump over to Ezekiel 15. Ezekiel 15. We have this vine that is not producing what was expected. In Ezekiel 15, beginning in verse 1, it says, "And the word of the Lord came unto me, saying, Son of man, what is the vine tree more than any tree, or than a branch which is among the trees of the forest? Shall wood be taken thereof to do any work? Or will men make or take a pin of it to hang any vessel thereon? Behold, it is cast into the fire for fuel. The fire devoureth both the ends of it, and the midst of it is burned. Is it meat for any work? Behold, when it was whole, it was meat for no work. How much less shall it be meat yet for any work when the fire hath devoured it and that it is burned?" And so basically what the Lord is saying here is, what is a useless vine good for? Nothing but to be what? Burned. Nothing but to be burned. You don't make tools out of it. You don't make knickknacks out of it to hang on the wall. It's nothing good but for fuel. And then he says in verse 6, "Therefore, thus saith the Lord God, as the vine tree among the trees of the forest, which I have given to the fire for fuel, so will I give the inhabitants of Jerusalem." So Israel was a vine that God wanted to see much fruit come from. God planted it, but it never bore the desirable fruits of righteousness. So what did God do? He destroyed it, right? He allowed it to be burned. But now turn back to Jeremiah chapter 33. Saying, what a workout. Jeremiah chapter 33. And we're going to see the Lord make a messianic prophecy here. Jeremiah chapter 33, verse 15. He says, "In those days and at that time will I cause the branch of righteousness to grow up unto David, and he shall execute judgment and righteousness in the land. In those days shall Judah be saved, and Jerusalem shall dwell safely. And this is the name wherewith she shall be called, the Lord our righteousness." So the picture here, folks, is of a vine that has been cut off, right? Israel, it's a picture of this vine that has been cut off, and all that's left is a stump. And out of that stump comes another growth. What does Jeremiah call it? In my Bible, it's actually capitalized. Verse 16. A branch, all right? Out of this stump, out of this destroyed stump is going to raise up a branch. And Zechariah speaks of this branch in Zechariah chapter 6. All right, go ahead and jump over to Zechariah chapter 6. He's speaking of the same branch where he says in verse 12, "And speak unto him, saying, Thus speaketh the Lord of hosts, saying, Behold, the man whose name is the branch, and he shall grow up out of his place, and he shall build the temple of the Lord. Even he shall build the temple of the Lord, and he shall bear the glory, and shall sit and rule upon his throne. He shall be a priest upon his throne, and the council of peace shall be between them both." So here's another prophecy of the Messiah, the branch. In verse 13, we see that this branch will be called a what? He will be a prophet, proclaiming the council of peace. He will be a priest and he will be a king as he sits upon the throne. Now, let me try to tie all of this together now, to try to make some sense of it. So the Old Testament, and if you were a Jew, you would have been familiar with the Old Testament teachings about the Messiah. And so the Old Testament taught that Israel was a vine that was planted by God for the purpose of providing fruit that would glorify God. All right? That's what the picture is. But centuries went by, and they bore nothing but wild grapes, nothing what God had expected. So what did God do? He destroyed them. All right? He cut them down. He cut off right at the roots, but what did he leave? He left a stump. And God promised that up out of that stump would grow a branch. That branch would be a prophet, a priest, and a king. He would be God's own servant. And out of this vine will come the fruit that God had been looking for throughout the ages. Out of this vine would be that fruit of righteousness and holiness. This vine will bear the fruit of righteousness and peace. That's the vine Israel is looking for. And then listen, folks, Jesus says this, "I am the true vine." What is he acknowledging when he says that? I'm the branch. I'm the one that you've been waiting for. I am the true vine. And in that first phrase, folks, of verse 15, all of the Old Testament prophecies about a branch were fulfilled in that phrase. I'm him. I'm the branch. Jesus chose this metaphor not because he thought this would be a cool metaphor that people would get. He chose this metaphor because he also said these scriptures are fulfilled. I am this true vine. And now jump back to John 15. That's just kind of the background for John chapter 15. So Jesus says, I am the true vine. I am the one that has been promised by the Father. You know, Israel is not the true vine. There are those, it's amazing, there are people that are not Jewish, but are trying to be connected with Israel. Remember, Israel felt that through their connection to Abraham, that they were okay. And there are people that think, you know what, even though I'm not Jewish, maybe I can get on board and somehow become a proselyte so that I can be associated with Judaism and therefore be associated with God. They're not the vine. They're not the true vine. Israel is not it. Listen, the issue isn't your relationship to some nation. The issue isn't your relationship to some religious belief. The issue is your personal relationship to the true vine. That's what matters. The only way that you can have a relationship, a connection, a fundamental connection with the true vine is by believing in him as your Messiah, believing in him as your Savior from your sin. You see, this Jesus, the Messiah, came and he died for your sakes. He bore all of our sin upon the cross. He died. He suffered the penalty for it, so that we could have our sins forgiven. The only way you can have that organic connection is by believing in him. The only way you can receive the source of strength and life is by believing in him. If you've never done that, well, we're going to see what happens to those that don't do it. Now, this relationship alone doesn't necessarily bring forth that desired fruit. Just having that connection isn't naturally going to bring that desired fruit. That's why there is a vine dresser. Who's the vine dresser? The Father is the vine dresser. And Jesus identifies him as that. And we see that the nature of God the Father's work depends on the relationship of the branch to the vine. All right, we see that in those first three verses. If the branches aren't bearing fruit, what does the vine dresser do? He cuts it away. I don't know if you've ever grown anything, tomatoes or whatever, but every now and then when you go out and you look at your plants, you'll see that there'll be all these green shoots, and then there'll be a brown one, right, or two. And obviously that is what? It's a sucker, but it's dead. It's right. It's dead. And you think, wow, that's really crazy. How could something that is dead be connected to something that is alive? But that happens. And that's why this is a really good illustration, because that happens spiritually also. It can happen spiritually. There are branches that have some interest in the vine. They want to have this connection, but they don't believe. They have other reasons, maybe an interest, like many of the people followed Christ, to see if they could be fed by him, or to see if they could see these miracles from him, right? Not having a true connection, not really believing in it. Remember when Jesus confronted the crowds, many of them left when he revealed to them what discipleship really meant. And Jesus said to the 12, are you going to leave too? And they said, no. So there are those that would be near Christ, that would say they participate, but are not alive. They're suckers, as somebody had said. And so the Father cuts them away. That's what it says in verse 2. Every branch in me that beareth not fruit, he taketh away. And that's the idea of cutting away. And you've done that. I do that with tomato plants. If they're dead, I break off the branches, right? And you've done the same thing. But if the branches are bearing fruit, then the vine dresser does something else too. There's still a cutting going on. A vine dresser will cut back those places so that they can bear more fruit. The branches some of those are cut back so they can bear more fruit. And folks, the point is that in both cases, there's cutting going on. If there's a dead branch and a fruitful branch, the vine dresser knows, and he does cutting in both cases. And sometimes I think his cutting back actually is mistaken for a cutting away in the lives of those who are truly saved. When God works in your life, folks, sometimes Christians think that God has forsaken them because he's trying to purge them. And we get it all wrong in our flesh, and the devil, they both deceive us, try to deceive us into thinking, look, God has cut you away. How do I know that? Because he's allowing you to go through difficulties. He's allowing that to happen. But no, God is not cutting them away. God is cutting things out of them that would hinder growth for fruit. That's a blessed, blessed picture. That's what the vine dresser does, folks. And so Jesus is referring to people who have a real relationship with God's true vine. There is a fruit that he desires, and he clips away at anything that would hinder that kind of good fruit. Now, try to imagine this if you can. This is God revealing to us what's going on in our lives. And to me, along with the other passages that we have been looking at over the last few months about God being in control of everything, this picture is so comforting to me. If you can think of the Father, God the Father, taking such personal interest in you and picturing him with these clippers over you, just like a vine dresser would be over each branch, looking at each leaf, looking at each stalk, cutting away those that are dead, but precisely clipping away anything on a good branch that would hinder it from bearing more fruit, carefully holding each of us in his hand, giving his undivided attention to us. That's what's going on in your life. When you got up this morning, if there was some issue that was pressing on your heart, you know what that was? The vine dresser. That was the vine dresser giving you individual attention. When that circumstance that you are dealing with that just bears heavy on your heart, you know what that is? That's the vine dresser. He's working in you. He's clipping away at things. Folks, nothing about clipping is happy, right? When if you ever got clipped by scissors accidentally, it's not something you rejoice over, right? It's something that hurts. It brings about pain. What a wonderful picture that the Father is watching over us that way. But what is the instrument? And we've talked about many different instruments. But what is the instrument that God uses to purge or to cut out, cut back on the branches? And immediately we think of what? What does God use to purge us? Oftentimes we think what? The trials, right? That's immediately what comes to mind. But you were right if you said the word, because that's what he says right here, right? Trials and difficulties are things that God uses, but Jesus says in verse 3, ye are clean or purged through what? Through the word which I have spoken unto you. You see, folks, God will use the loss of a job, our financial distress. He'll use relationship problems or sickness, and those things can be sharp. They can be cutting. But if it wasn't for the scriptures, we wouldn't know what to make of that.
That's right.
Right? It's the word that does the work. Right. Right? There are people today that are constantly asking, why? Why? Why does this happen to me? You, as a believer, have the answer.
Right.
See, it's not the action that does the purging. It's the action in the context of the word that gives you purpose. That helps you to see God's hand in it. Mm-hmm. Folks, I'll tell you what, there's nothing more encouraging than that. When you're going through the clipping, when God is purging you to recognize this is the individual attention of God in my life,
right,
to help me to bear more fruit for him. Because that's ultimately what he wants,
right,
that we would bear more fruit. You know, we couldn't understand the purpose of our trials except through the Word of God. And so God uses those circumstances, but the Scripture is what makes the cut. That's what cuts out that dead growth. And that's what clips off the suckers that would really take away the valuable nutrition, right? What a picture, right? This valuable nutrition that could be channeled into something that would bear more fruit. There are things in our lives, folks. There are attitudes in our lives that are hindering fruit bearing. And what God does as He carefully looks at your life, He brings our attention to that. How about this? Somebody says something to you, and immediately your face gets red. Immediately something comes to mind, right? Some thought that you want to say because you're angry. You know what that is? That's God looking at a trait that's undesirable, bringing it to your attention, not so that you can carry through with it, but so you can clip it, so it can be clipped. Like when the disciples were in the boat with Christ, right? They're in the midst of this storm. And what would have been the desired fruit, right? What do you think the Lord wanted to see in their lives while they're being bounced around in this storm? The Lord would want to see faith, right? But instead, they cried out to the Lord in fear. Jesus says, "Why are you so fearful?" Clip. Why are you so fearful? The unwanted growth was what? Fear. That was unwanted, right? That was hindering them from growing, from bearing fruit. And then He says this, "Where is your faith?" That's the desired growth, right? So He brings to the attention there the unwanted growth, that it can be clipped, and He acknowledges what the desired fruit is. And folks, in that circumstance, it wasn't the storm that pruned. It was Jesus' words that interpreted the storm, right? The storm revealed your fear. It's your faith that needs to shine forth. And we see this happening in the lives of the disciples as we read throughout the Gospels. And folks, it happens in our lives every day. That's what God is doing in your life. Just a few months from this, when the Lord was on the storm of the sea with them, you see that these are men who are changed. These are men where fruit is being produced in their lives, fruit that is pleasing to God. But they had to have their branches pruned by God. They had to allow it. Folks, this chopping away at unwanted growth is necessary if we're to bear fruit. You just can't get away from it. You know, that's why it's ludicrous for us to say, "God, deliver me from this." Right? "God, get me out of this." As if God doesn't have any control of you being in it. God has you in it because He wants to reveal things to you so that you can bear more fruit. And so our prayer ought to be, "God, show me. Show me what is the desired fruit here, that I might abide by that instead of abiding by the fruit that needs to be clipped away." And do you know that goes on in services like this? We have services like this, or in Sunday school where the Word of God is preached. It goes on all the time. If you're connected to the true vine, folks, you're a partaker of His life, then when God's Word is preached, right now there is cutting going on. In your life, there is something, somewhere, that the Spirit of God is going to bring to your attention and say, "That's what I'm doing." Remember when you were asking God why? Remember when you were saying, "God, I don't understand"? This is your understanding. I'm clipping. I'm taking away those things that will hinder you from growing and bearing fruit. Thank you, God. Thank you, God, for caring so much for me that You would give me that undivided attention, that You would get those things that are displeasing to You out of my life so that I could please You in bearing fruit. So there is this cutting back that we might bear more fruit. And that's why it's important, folks, to be tuned in to the Lord. But as I said before, it's also, there is this cutting away. And that's referring to those that are not saved. God cuts away those who are superficially attached. And that's the thing, folks. We can't always tell who that is. Only God can tell who that is. I mean, Jesus had 12 disciples, and one of them was a devil, right? Now, Jesus knew who that was, but the other disciples didn't have a clue, did they? And really, even when you look at a group our size, chances are, percentage-wise, I know, you know, if I were to look around and look at your testimonies, I'd say, no, you have a testimony of salvation. But even in a group our size, typically, there would be a percentage of those that have not really believed on the Lord Jesus Christ. But how would we know? They're connected, right? They're close to the vine. They're expressing an interest in the vine, but the problem is there's no fruit. And you know, folks, that doesn't go on for a long time. You know why? Because there's a vine dresser. There's a vine dresser who looks upon a body like ours, right? We're connected to the vine. Our church represents those branches. And so the vine dresser is looking for things to clip off of us so that we'll bear more fruit. But also, as he sees those things that are not bearing fruit at all because there's no life, he clips away at them. And folks, we have seen that. All churches have observed that. They may come to a church for a while. They may even have been baptized, but they've never produced anything for God. Their spirit is utterly carnal. And although we as believers are loving, you know, we don't come to quick judgments and tell people, well, you're not saved, right? But you shall know them by their fruits. God knows them by their fruits. And what happens, though, even in the body, God understands the importance. If somebody wants to be close and not really be saved, that's not good for a body. God will clip it away. And they'll leave the body. And they'll have no interest in the things of God. And then God just cuts them away. And you'll notice one day, and you know what I'm talking about, they're just gone. They're just gone. And they don't go anywhere else. They just are gone. And verse 6 says, if a man abide not in me, he is cast forth as a branch and is withered. That's a sad reality. But it happens. These are people that we've grown to love. People maybe that we've always thought were saved. Yet God does that purging. They just wither up. So it's important that we examine ourselves, right? It's so important that we examine ourselves. Do you truly have the life of Christ pulsing through you? Do you really know beyond a shadow of a doubt that you are saved? I'm not trying to get you to think you're unsaved if you're saved. I don't want you to doubt the truth of your salvation. But if you've never truly been saved, if there's never been any fruit in your life, I want to warn you, at least go before God and get the confidence from him according to his word. Because you know what? I would rather you doubt now and take care of it than think you're saved, and when you think you're going to end up in heaven, you don't end up there. And I'm sure that nobody would say when we get to heaven, man, why'd you have to give me such a hard time? You know, I mean, I thought it was saved. Why do you have to give me? No, you're going to be saying, thank you.
Right.
Thank you for causing me to look within.
Yes.
And to going to God to see if I really am saved. I've been told I was saved. I thought I was saved. But there was never that organic connection. There was never any fruit. May God help us to know for sure. If you have that connection, if you find that when you come to a place like this, that there's something that cuts you to the quick. You know, when you leave a service like this or any other service, there should be something that God reveals to you. As a believer, listen, this is not just happenstance, right? When you come here, God has something for you.
Right.
God wants you to leave with something. If you leave with nothing, something's wrong. Something's wrong. So you ought to come here with something. There ought to be some cutting that goes on in some way, right? Where as the Word of God is read, something about the Word of God is read, some people are cut by things that aren't even the theme of the message. The reading of a corresponding passage, God has oftentimes clipped people. It's His Word that does it. And if that happens, you can thank God for that. Thank God that you're a productive branch. Thank God that His Father gives you that kind of attention so that you can bear fruit from Him for Him. God wants to use that issue in your life, that circumstance you're going through. He wants to use that to cause you to bear more fruit. And that's what He wants us to do, is to bear more fruit. Now, if you don't have that connection, if you're here this morning and you don't know that you have that connection to the true vine, the Messiah, we would love to be able to show you from the Word of God how you can have that assurance, how you can have the power, the source of power of Jesus Christ running through you. You can have that assurance. But if you've never believed on the Lord Jesus Christ, we'd love to show you how to do so. And Christian, I want to encourage you, whatever that thing is, whatever those circumstances are, look to the Lord for it, right? Seek Him as to why you're going through that. Let Him purge what needs to be gone. Let Him purge whatever that attitude or that action that's going on in your life that is keeping you from bearing the fruit. And listen, even as believers, it's possible for us not to bear the fruit we ought to. And one day you know that we're going to stand before Him and our works are going to be tried so as by fire. Some are going to receive rewards. Some are going to suffer loss. Now's the time to think about that. Right? Now's the time to say, God, do Your purging. Help me to yield to that purging. I'm telling you, when I think about that, I do thank Him. Because how quickly do we look at difficult circumstances as just things that are bad for me? Right? I don't want to get up today. I've got to face another day. I've got to face this and that. And the whole time the Lord is saying, look, I'm trying to clip this. Will you get out of the way? Will you accept this truth? Recognize that that attitude is not good fruit? Get rid of it. Let me purge it so that you can bear good fruit. I'm telling you what, living a life bearing good fruit is marvelous. It is great, folks. Yield to the Spirit and allow that to happen in your life for God's glory. Let's pray. Lord God in heaven, we praise You for the truth of Your Word. Jesus Christ indeed is the true vine. He is the Messiah. He is the branch that rose up out of the stump of Israel. We praise You, Lord, for the accuracy of Your truth. We praise You for the precision of Your prophecy. And Lord, I do pray that as we consider that, that it would just cause us to love You more, to appreciate You more, to trust in You more. I do pray, Lord, that You would help us to see ourselves as You see us, as those who are organically connected to the true vine. I pray, Lord, that we would be mindful of Your command to bear fruit. I pray, Father, that we would seek that we would allow You to remove anything in our lives that would hinder us from bearing the fruit that would be pleasing to You. I ask You, Father, to go with us as we go our ways this afternoon. I pray that if there's anybody here that doesn't know You as Savior, that through the preaching of the Word, through the testimony of others, that, Lord, they would come to an understanding of their need. If there is someone here, Lord, that believes he or she is truly saved, yet there's been no fruit, there's really been no great desire to be with God's people or to grow in Your Word or to serve You, I pray, Lord, that You would cause him or her to question their testimony. And Lord, I pray if there's anyone here that needs to be saved, that You would urge them in a great way. Again, Lord, I pray that You would be with our dads. I ask You to minister to them today. Pray that You would bless them as they get together with families. I pray that as families remember their dads, Lord, just that You would just give peace and joy. And I pray that you would bring us all back again tonight for another opportunity to look into your word for your glory, that we might apply these things. Lord, help us not merely to be hearers of the word, but that we would be doers of your word for your sake. We love you, Father. We ask it all in Jesus' wonderful name. Amen. 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 Let's take our hymnals again. Turn to hymn number 317. Thank you for being with us today. I trust you have a wonderful day. I'm sure all you fathers have wonderful testimonies of breakfast in bed and such. I do want to mention that we do have a gift for each of you. And I am, reluctantly, I have to mention, I forgot gifts for moms on Mother's Day. I'm sorry. Today, we're going to hand out gifts to mothers and fathers, all right? So if you're a mother or a father, our ushers are going to try to get all of you with all of these different gifts. So you'll have so much stuff to look through this afternoon. It'll be a great afternoon. But don't forget, we have a choir at 4:45 tonight. There is a meeting of all of those that play the piano at 5:15. I'm not exactly sure where that's going to be. Where is it? Down in the fellowship hall. And then, of course, we have our evening service at 6 p.m. Vernon, you have something else? Okay, so hopefully you don't have any pianists that are puppet players. All right, so anyhow, let your conscience be your guide. Right? Amen. All right, look around. There are those that are not here. Some are not feeling well. Others have issues they're dealing with. Be an encouragement. Maybe you could give them a call, let them know that you miss them, and urge them to come and fellowship with us. We will be here tonight looking into the Word of God once again, and I hope that you'll be here then. Thank you so much for being with us. You are dismissed.